on, everybody, put your hand together. I want to hear you say Sunday morning.
Sunday morning.
Sunday morning.
Welcome to Sunday Morning Service. Today we'll be featuring a sermon by the Reverend C.L. Franklin entitled The Barren Fig Tree and song selections from the Mississippi Mass Choir, the Pilgrim Jubilees, and the Sensational Nightingales. Now sit back, relax, and enjoy Sunday Morning Service.
Mississippi song. real good and now
I'm enjoying my blessing.
I thank him for blessing me real good and now
I'm enjoying my blessing.
I'm enjoying
the good thing
the Lord has done for me. Let's say it again. The Lord been blessing me real good.
I'm enjoying my blessing.
I thank him for blessing me real good and now
I'm enjoying my blessing.
The Lord been blessing me real good and now
I'm enjoying my blessing.
I'm enjoying
the good thing the Lord has done for me.
He blessed me to see the sun shining. Every day I rise and see a new dawning. But that's not all he done for me. He gave me clothes to wear and food to eat.
The good thing the Lord has done for me.
The Lord been blessing me real good.
I'm enjoying my blessing.
I thank him. Thank him for blessing me real good. And now
I'm enjoying my blessing.
The Lord been blessing me real good. And now
I'm enjoying my blessing.
I'm enjoying
the good thing.
Me real good and now
I'm enjoying my blessing.
The Lord been blessing me real good and now
I'm enjoying my blessing.
I'm enjoying
the good thing the Lord has done for me.
Listen. There's no respect of persons, I know that's true. Whatever he done for me, he'll do it for you. Listen. Lately, to me it seemed that he'd been spending more time on clean.
The Lord has done for me.
Let's talk about it a while.
What he done for me.
Let's talk about it a while.
What he done for me.
What he done for me.
What he done for me.
Wanna tell the world.
What he done for me.
He let me live.
What he done for me.
A little while.
What he done for me.
He opened up.
What he done for me.
He let me live a little while longer. That's what he done for
me. What he done for me.
Let me tell you another thing. He gave me health and strength. That's what he done for me. And I just want to tell him, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for what you done for me. When I was out
gone,
oh, you took me in. When I was lonely, oh, you was my cup of tea. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Ah, thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for what you done for me. I can tell.
The third chapter, or the 13th chapter, beginning with the 6th through the 10th verse. He spake also this parable. A certain man had a fig tree planted in a vineyard, and he came and sought fruit thereon and found none. Then said he unto the dresser of the vineyard, behold, these 3 years I come seeking fruit on this fig tree and find none. Cut it down. Why cumbereth it the ground? And he answering said unto him, Lord, let it alone this year also, till I shall dig about it and dung it. And if it bear fruit, well. And if not, then after that thou shalt cut it down. the barren fig tree. Let me acknowledge the presence of a very fine friend and member in the person of Mrs. Winona Carr, who is now traveling with the Rosetta Tharpe Company. We were happy to have her with us today. She sang for us beautifully today. We're kind of hoping that she was going to sing tonight, but she's with us also tonight. God bless her in her going and coming. The barren fig tree. The barren fig tree. Jesus always made his parables live. Whatever idea that he wanted to convey, he was imaginative enough and skillful enough in rhetorical presentation to present his thoughts and his pictures in characterization. And how beautiful and how challenging are his characterizations. When he got ready to teach us the lesson of the love of God,
yes, sir,
he closed it in the characterization of a father with two sons. And one went away and the other one stayed at home. When he got ready to show God's concern about those of us who have strayed,
yes, sir,
he closed the idea and the characterization of a shepherd,
yes,
searching on wild and barren and lonely hillsides,
yes, sir, yes, sir,
for sheep that had gone astray.
Yes, sir.
And here, he presents a challenging picture to us on the idea of a barren life.
Yes.
Yes.
An empty life.
Uh-huh.
A life that is lived to no avail.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Wow. A life that is lived to no good end.
Yes,
most of the people who have heard me preach through the years have heard me refer to this, that many people that are living in the world today are just here just to make out another number.
Yes.
They aren't doing anything, and I'm trying to do anything.
Amen.
Amen.
They can't do anything for making excuses and pitying themselves.
Yes.
A great many folk could do a lot better than they're doing if they'd stop feeling sorry for themselves and get up and do something. Because the world doesn't like crybabies. I don't like to meet people and every time you meet them, they're crying. A lot of things that happen to me, I don't tell people because I know it doesn't help you too much. You see, the world like to go along with a winner. Things may not be going the best with you, and things don't go the best with anybody at all times. There must be some cloudy days, as well as some sunshiny days. So some people cannot live a worthy, a life that is constructed. Some people cannot live an abundant life because they are too busy whining and complaining. Too busy making excuses for themselves.
Amen.
So I'm trying to say, my friends, Jesus here, in the characterization of a fig tree,
that was situated in a favorite spot with all of the attending advantages. And yet it produced nothing but leaves. Nothing but leaves. Nothing but leaves. Listen, if you please. Now, envisage that fig tree sitting on a sunny hillside. With no encumbrance, with no overshadowing influence to dissipate its energy. With nothing to obstruct it. With the sun and air enriching its branches. And the gardener attending the garden in which it was situated. For not only was it in a good place in a garden, but it was in a favorite spot in the garden. I don't believe you're friends with me tonight. You look like you kind of sleep with it. It was in a favorite spot.
I'm waiting for you, sir.
In the garden. And not only was it enclosed, and the beast and other things that would injure or hinder it were fenced out, but somebody went in there where it was and attended it. Pray with me if you please. But the owner of the vineyard went by and looked on its branches for fig. The tree was in a good place. The limbs were extended. The foliage was green. And it had all of the appearance of a productive tree. And yet when the owner got back, there were no figs among its branches. Good God Almighty. When the owner searched in vain among its limbs, looked in vain among its leaves, and found nothing, the owner became impatient, and the owner became angry, and the owner denounced the tree and said to the gardener, cut it down. Why does it encumber the ground? To what end is it using the soil and the productivity of the soil? It's not bearing any fruit. It's not helping anybody. So why keep it? Pray with me if you please. But when the owner leveled this indictment and this judgment against this non-productive tree, the gardener, who had charge of the garden, said to the owner, Lord, spare another year.
I wish you'd pray with me.
Spare another year. Give it one more year. Let me dig around it. Let me fertilize it. Let me open up the ground around its roots. And let the freezing rain and the fertilizing snow fall in around the roots. And then if it doesn't bring forth fruit, cut it down. I wish I had somebody here to pray with you tonight. Cut it down. Cut it down. My brethren and my sisters, I'm afraid that many of us are like the barren fig tree standing and situated on sunny hillsides of God's grace.
I'm waiting for you.
Standing and living on the sunny hillsides of God's love with every opportunity to do good. With every opportunity to live worthwhile life. With every opportunity to live constructive life. With every opportunity opportunity to renew your promises with God. Who told the Lord that I'm going to do something for you? And yet those promises have died, and your life has come, have become a life of leaves. I'm afraid that when the owner of your life, God, looked on the bridges of your life, I'm afraid too many of us, he found nothing but leaves. The leaves of excuses. The leaves of self-pity. The leaves of self-indulgence. The leaves of pleasure. The leaves of criticism. The leaves of hiding behind somebody else. I'm afraid that too many of our lives are nothing but leaves. Leaves look good, but they are very little use. They look all right. They dress up the tree, but nobody eats leaves. If you go to a fruit tree, you go there looking for fruit. You don't go there looking for leaves. But I'm afraid that on the branches of our lives we have far more leaves than we have fruit. I'm afraid, my brothers and my sisters, Jesus himself has had to plead on our behalf. Tell God to not cut us down. Petition God on our behalf to let us stand for another year. Too many people, when they pass on to the other side, and we look upon their caskets and see those little words, at rest, too many of them, it means that, doesn't necessarily mean rather that they are at rest. It means the folk that knew them are at rest. Sometimes it means that wife is at rest. Sometimes it means that husband is at rest. Sometimes it means the neighbors are now at rest. Sometimes it means the church that they were members of are now at rest. Getting it so? I'm trying to say, brothers and sisters, we ought to live so that when we pass on, the world will miss us. Our lives will be like the life of Ingersoll. It is said that when Ingersoll orated and eulogized at the funeral of a friend, he said his life was like, you understand, a sea, a great ocean, for it touched upon many shores of human thought. I think our lives ought to have many facets, many branches of goodwill. That when we are gone, the world will miss us. And somebody will know that somebody worthwhile has passed on. And somebody will be inspired as a result of the fact that we have lived. You know, we like to dream of immortality. We like to dream of living again. But I want to tell you that I want to live again with God. But I want to keep on living in somebody else's life. Oh Lord, I want some boy or some girl to look on me and say, I'd like to be like him. And that my life is better now that I've known it. As I've gone up through life, his words will follow me. And his deeds will not forsake me. I don't believe you're praying with me. Oh, Lord. And I hear my God saying right now, I don't believe you know what I'm talking about. Oh, Lord, spam another year. Another year. Yes. I don't want to be a worthless tree. No, no. I want to be a tree like that tree that was planted on Mount Lebanon. They tell me that the trees on Mount Lebanon, the cedar tree there, the many times the storms rise, many times the winds blow, and tourists wonder why they stand so firm. Oh Lord, but somebody said to them, oh Lord, those trees, they have an anchoring in that mountain. Down in the mountain, there's a rock. Oh yeah, and every cedar on the mountain grows down until it strikes the rock, and then it spreads out fan wide and go down beside the rock. Yes, it does, and then groan under the rock, and the roots tie and mingle themselves together beneath that rock. And when they wrap around the rock, and the rock become a part of that foundation, yes, the wind may blow and the storm may rise. The old tree may reel and rock from one side to another, but when the wind's over, the tree is standing upright. Yeah, its top been dragging the ground. Its body's been twisted. Yeah, but after a while, the storm rides. After a while, the clouds roll away. After a while, the sunshine. And that's what I've tried to do. I'm on the mountain of my God's salvation. Yes, I am. I've let the roots of my faith grow down in the mountain and strike the rock of ages. Yes. And then go on down and wrap around that rock. Yes. And let the wind rock me from side to side. Oh, yeah. Let the wind go. Let them rock me from one side to another. Let them shake me every day. Yeah. Yeah. When the wind's over. Yeah. When the storm is through blowing. Yeah. I'm going to stand upright on my God's word. I don't believe you know what I'm talking about. Yeah. This year, I'm going to try to do a little better. This year, in 1955, if I live the life of Lee's, I'm going to try to do a little better. This year, I'm going to dig around with prayer. This year, I'm going to dig around with faith. This year, I'm going to dig around my life with service. Yes, I am. This year, I'm going to bow a little more. This year, I'm gonna sing a little more. This year, I'm gonna serve a little more. This year, I'm gonna do a little bit more goodwill. This year, I'm gonna encourage a little more. Yes, I am. Every day, I'm gonna try to do a little more. May God bless you. May God bless you. May you all realize that we are all trees. And that we are trees that God is expecting service out of our lives. It's a question of whether or not we are producing the fruit that God is looking for.
Drag the linen.
Yes, sir.
Some of you who are listening to me tonight,
take us down home.
We realize that you've been living a life.
Yeah.
Some of you that's listening here tonight can look among the leaves of your own life and see if you have any fruit there. Remember, you have not lived a profitable life. Remember, Jesus is pleading for you. Lord, spare them another year. Give them another chance. And if they live another year and produce no more fruit, after they've been giving a full chance, then Lord, cut them down. Cut them down. But I will leave with you, since I know I'm a tree in the Lord's garden. And since I know that my God is looking for fruit out of my garden, I will leave with you tonight. I'm on my way to heaven. I think we ought to have an understanding. I think we ought to know what we're about. If you're on your way, you ought to set. If you're on your way, you ought to not mind saying. I'm on my way to heaven. Get on your way. No, you've been living a life with me. Know that the branches of your life are not laden with the fruit of God's service. Come home right now. No. Somebody didn't talk that way. Somebody didn't say a mumbling word. Somebody. If you know you've been born into this family, you're not mine, say it. And let the world know. Do you know what being born again means?
We hope you have enjoyed this week's edition of Sunday Morning Service. Be sure to subscribe to Malaco Gospel so you'll be notified when new programming is available. Again, thank you for participating in Sunday Morning Service.
If the world from you withhold all of its silver and its gold, and you have to get along with meager fare, Christians, just remember in His word how He feeds the the little bird. Take your burden
to the Lord.
Take it to him and leave it there, cheer.
Leave it there.
Leave it there. Leave it there. Won't you
leave your burden there?
Church, take your burden. Christians, if your body suffers pain and your health you can't regain, and your soul is almost sinking in despair, you know what, church? Jesus knows the pain you feel. He can save and I know he can heal. Take your burden, won't you take it to him and leave it there. Thanks, leave it there. Get heavy sometime, but take your
burden,
take it to him when the tears won't stop falling. Yes, my friend, all you got to do is just trust in God. Are gone and old age is staring on, and your body bends beneath the weight of care. You know what, church? He will never leave. He'll go with you to the end. Take your burden,
burden,
take your burden, and leave it there. Saints, remember, leave it there.
Trouble,
take your burden.
To the Lord.
He knows what to do about it.
Burden
to
back.